Welcome back. The Department of Home Affairs held a symposium today on Gauteng's East Rand on the repositioning of the Home Affairs Department. Home Affairs Minister Hlengiwe Mkhize says her department will use technology to assist other departments such as health and education to track the number of foreign nationals accessing government services. To tell us more on this and other issues, I'm now joined in studio by Home Affairs Minister Proffesor Hlengiwe Mkhize. Minister, thank you so much for joining us.
Good evening to the listeners. Good evening to you. Thank you for having me.
I know it's always good to have you, and you've just told me how exhausted you are. You've had a very intense and hopefully a very, well, delightful, in a sense, symposium all day, trying to look at ways to reposition the Home Affairs Department. Tell us more about how you plan to reposition the Home Affairs Department.
Yeah, I think this workshop in particular was quite significant because we had the first one. We had a very good audience reflecting with us as to how do we move the department forward from what it used to be in the past, Undaba Zabantu. And today I think we had panels of informed people, experts, who articulated issues in a way which will make our life easier early next year when we work on a white paper. Because remember, the Department of Home Affairs, it hasn't got an act. It comes from an era where it was governed from our colonial powers in the UK. So basically, you know, what we are trying to do is to really look at the mandate and say, how do we ensure that the mandate is carried out to the benefit of the nationals of South Africa first. So we looked at the national identity system, that in a new Department of Home Affairs, it should be completely different from what it was in the past, where your name could be spelled wrongly, where the documents were getting lost. They should be all secured, done through the modern technologies. But also we looked at issues of international migration, that all having done and said, nationals like South Africa are under pressure from foreign nationals, sometimes who create a burden, not only development, the good aspects of it, but also a burden on service structures like health and education. And luckily we had the MEC from Limpopo, who is at the border of the busiest port of entry, the MEC for Health. She was sharing her experiences about the difficulties they have by not being able to say no. And so they have a high percentage of the patients that they have to see and treat and do everything in line with their oath, but who are not really budgeted for. And in no time they start saying, oh, we've run out of our budget. I think the MEC for Gauteng in education really look at the same aspects of children who are not necessarily South Africans, but whom they have to carry because of also, we all looked at our constitution as well.
Now, Minister, I'm actually glad you mentioned the foreign nationals because, I mean, that's one of criticisms that the Home Affairs Department has had to face in terms of, you know, documenting foreign nationals adequately. Why do you think it's taken us so long to start having these conversations, or have these conversations taken place before, but it was an issue of implementation and maybe having the right, firstly, skills, but also the right technology, I guess, in this new age to ensure that people are adequately documented?
I think this concept of repositioning, it comes a long way, as far back as 2010 or 2007. But I suppose it has taken time for the department to really be clear with pillars of a repositioned Home Affairs. Remember, for too long we're stuck with a green ID book. And then we saw forgeries, people pasting the wrong pages
people
and so on.
People being married off?
People being married offline. And generally, you know, today there was a presentation on national interest, really saying how do we swing also the public's mindset to realize that whatever this department, the mandate is about national security. One official used an example that if a person comes and says, hey, hey man, I want a visa or I want this, you must realize that you are being invited to compromise the security of your own country. So it has taken us for too long, but there's much more clear. There have been trials with the smart cards, which nobody can manipulate. All what we need to do is to make sure that each and every citizen carries a smart card for security reasons. When it comes to border management, it's clear that a lot more needs to be done to deal with the situation of unaccompanied minors, the smuggling of women, and the syndicates, powerful syndicates at our ports who work full-time smuggling people in and out of the country. And South Africa being the most developed country with more prospects for jobs, for opportunities, we carry the burden of receiving, while the push factor will be from countries in our neighborhood where there's very little going on. There was a very strong panel which looked at the economic aspects, especially economic inclusion. And again, they said the department's mandate is to secure the first document on your road to economic inclusion. That is your identity. And it's your right as a citizen, but also it leads to all sorts of entry points as an entrepreneur and workplace, setting up your own business and even doing a business within the region. You have to have the appropriate documents. You have to have the passport that is valid and authentic. And you have to really have that stamp of your country that you are a national with a good reputation.
Now, Minister, I want us to shift gear a little bit and talk about some of the issues that your department has been facing recently. First being that SCA ordering that the department open the refugee office that was closed in Cape Town in 2012. What's your view on the judgment?
You know, I think even the question of refugees, it's a big issue for the country. Just next week, hopefully, we'll be in Geneva, where again, with all member states, we're looking at where we are and how much burden should, I mean, I don't want to use burden, it's a negative one. How much should countries honor their obligations and responsibility to assist the most vulnerable? Because refugees, they are the responsibility of the United Nations. So as member states, we have to assist. So the judgment was interesting for me, even the recent one, where it was said, you can't just deport these people. Even if you reject them, you say they don't fall under the category of refugees, they have to, within 48 hours, appear before a court of law. It put a lot of pressure in our offices, whereby the Department of Justice have to come on board. They have to work with us to make sure that they are given that opportunity. A decision is taken in a court of law. And there are things that we have had to do, working with the Human Rights Commission. They still want a workshop with us to look at their rights, their access to health, in our even where we deport them. You know, the expectation is that their health status should be monitored till they leave the country. We have a clinic that we run. We have international organizations overseeing the care of the refugees. So those were some of the challenges that we were discussing, that we are part of some obligations internationally, but also pressure point is from our own citizens who feel that as a country, first and foremost, we have a responsibility for protecting the rights of our own nationals.
Now, Minister, most recently, your department has been facing quite a tumultuous time, especially within the media, with regards to your long-serving Director General Mkhize Hlengiwe, and the potential legal challenge that the department might face with regards to his situation and his suspension. What exactly is going on there?
Well, as I have indicated, really, it's there are two phases of the story. It's an internal matter, low level, protected employer-employee, where we all, you know, in terms of our prescripts, are not supposed to be discussing. For the pending legal challenge and so on, it's sub judice, because once a person has filed in court, then you have to allow those processes to take place. But our side, there's really nothing major besides what is a normal practice. Sometimes to question certain things,
and of course, questioning is a fair thing. If a person in such a high position is suspended, naturally there'd be questions around it, reasons why they're suspended, and then they'll come out with their side of the story and some allegations, saying that you sought some assistance for your son through Mr. Apleni, and that's why, and because nothing was done for you, this is why he's being suspended. And those are some of the allegations that are coming up. You are new in this department, and I mean, you've recently just gotten into this position, and this must be difficult for you. But how do you manage this situation where now, it's directly involving your family? Your family is being brought into the mix of this, and then there's the issues of saying, why is he suspended? Because the questions will keep coming.
Yeah, I think, much as I've been careful, I did deal with that. So, yes, it's true. I'm new in the department, but I have been in government for quite some time. I understand processes and procedures. And so I think everything is under control. The program, the most important thing, the mandate is continuing. The program of the department is in safe hands. There are systems, starting with parliament and cabinet. So what's important for the public is protected. For the rest, I think we'll manage.
I think just to wrap up the discussion on the DG, just to say, what's the process now going forward? He has been suspended. I know you mentioned that it is sub judice at the moment, where some details of the suspension, but also of the discussions and the hearings, can't be discussed. But as a way forward, because now you're talking about repositioning, and you had the symposium on saying you're repositioning your department, and you're looking at new ways to improve your department. This person has been there for a very long time. Doesn't that sort of hinder processes? And what's the way forward looking at this situation as it stands?
You see, government, it works in terms of systems. It's not built on individuals. That's why I can work in the telecoms, I can work in correctional service, higher education. I get into a system and I move in with it. The highest authority is the president. He signed an agreement with ministers. I inherit, we have outcomes. So you inherit the outcomes from another person, you deliver in line. Of course, it will be strange in any organization to have a whole lot of senior officials who are not capable of doing anything, then it means you'll be a failed. If any organization is built on the individual, it means it's a failed organization. Israeli organizations, they work on systems. If you can manage the systems work irrespective of who is sitting on top. So we have not even been thinking about any aspect of our work which could be hindered by the illness or
loss of an individual,
of any person.
So in a nutshell, you're saying that the department will carry on with its work and it will be fine regardless of what happens to the DG at this point in time, and at a later stage, and once this situation has been resolved internally, because you say it is an internal matter, we will then know what exactly went on and what's going on within the department.
Yeah, you see, departments, they are within clusters. They are chairs of clusters. That's where the oversight sits and the guidance. Individuals within, you act, but there's a lot of guidance and support. So I will be surprised if in any of the entities of government, my absence or your absence or any one person's absence will make people not know what to do. It's a system.
Okay, we're running out of time now, but I just want to wrap up just looking at some of the collaborations that you have, just to shift focus a little bit. You mentioned earlier on that you're now in a position where, the Department of Justice will have to come in, where you're having workshops with them in order to assist the processes of the Department of Home Affairs going forward and that repositioning that we've been speaking about all evening. But in terms of the other departments that you mentioned, because you do need telecommunications, you mentioned health and education as well, how are you finding the collaborations to be working for you? Are people receptive of coming together with the Department of Home Affairs and really making this work for the country?
Well, as I've said, that government has clustered departments. Like, for instance, today we had people from the telecoms, We had people from defense who were looking at cybersecurity. We had people from economic sector who have been, you know, assisting government within the NDP framework to really contribute towards the economy. So generally, I think we are at the point where there's not even a single department that is in an island. We work in an integrated, coordinated fashion. I mean, if you look at some of the platforms we require for efficient, for our home affairs networks, you rely on the same CETA that the telecoms are driving. And the post office was in attendance also thinking that where there are no offices of home affairs, they have a footprint which could be utilized with our technology. So there's, I think, on the whole, we're at the point where we have moved away from a fragmented, individualistic department approach.
Minister, unfortunately, we've run out of time. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll definitely be keeping up with developments within your department.
Thank you.
That was Home Affairs Minister Hlengiwe Mkhize joining us live in studio for an in-depth discussion on some of the developments in her department. I'll be back with more news after the break. Don't go anywhere.